Colloquia series, and today we have with us Professor Joakim Nystrand. He's a full professor at the University of Bergen in Norway, and he did his PhD in 1996 at Lund, and after that he went to Berkeley to do his postdoc. He was at Berkeley for 3 years, and then he did another 3 years postdoc at Lund, and after that he got his professorship at Bergen. And Professor Nystrand has been working in Hadron experiments, first at SPS at CERN, and then he moved to BNL, where he worked both at STAR and at Phoenix. And then after several years, he moved to ALICE, and he's been working in ALICE for several years, working on ultra-peripheral collisions. And by the way, he will be here with us for 1 month, collaborating at the department. So if you miss the chance to discuss with him, he will be here for some time to discuss. And today he will talk about the energy frontier of electromagnetic and electroweak interactions using ultra-peripheral collisions at the LHC. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Daniel, for that introduction. Yes, I'm going to talk about ultra-peripheral collisions, and what is that? I define them as collisions between nuclei and protons with impact parameters larger than the sum of the radii. This means that no strong interactions are possible, so instead these interactions are mediated by the electromagnetic field, which, as you know, has a much longer range than the strong nuclear force. And these electromagnetic fields, as I will say a little bit more about in a minute, they correspond to an equivalent flux of photons, as was shown by Fermi and Weizsäcker-Williams. And it turns out that two-photon and photonuclear interactions can be studied at higher energies than anywhere before at the LHC in ultra-peripheral collisions. And since this is a colloquium and not everyone is an expert on high-energy nuclear or particle physics, I will start in a very elementary way, and looking at the electric and magnetic fields of a moving charged particle. And as you know, we say we have a situation where we have, for example, a gold or a lead nucleus with a size of about 7 Fermi radius. And suppose that we sit as an observer at a distance larger than this, for example, at 20 Fermi away from this nucleus. And if the nucleus is stationary, then velocity is equal to zero, then you have a constant electric field, obviously, and you have no magnetic field. But if you start to move this charge, giving it a rather small velocity, I mean, so that it's non-relativistic, say 10% of the speed of light, then the observer will see a time-dependent electric field. You will have a maximum when the ion is right, this is closest to you, and you will also start to induce a small magnetic field, because this moving charge, of course, corresponds to an electric current. But then, if you go to relativistic velocity, so you reach something like 98% of the speed of light, then something will happen. First of all, these field lines will be contracted, they will be Lorentz contracted, just as the nucleus, and the maximum amplitude will be enhanced by the Lorentz factor gamma compared to what you have in the stationary case. And if you look at this as a pulse, you see, because of this contraction, the duration of the field will be also be compressed. So it will be of the order of the impact parameter, these 20 Fermi divided by the speed of light times the Lorentz factor gamma. And you will also induce, at the same time, a B field of the same strength. So what you actually see is a time-varying electric and magnetic fields, which you get have a pulse of E and B fields moving past you, looking like this. So the strength of the E field is about the same as the B field, modulo factor C, and the E field is perpendicular to the B field. And this, you know, resembles very much the electromagnetic field associated with a single photon. So what Fermi concluded is that the effect of this field, this time-varying field, will be indistinguishable from that of an equivalent flux of photons with a continuous energy spectrum. And he did this calculation in 1924, and the paper is in Italian, but it has been translated and put on the archive some time ago, but if you're interested you can find it there. And it is actually quite accessible and readable. And I think I focus on this year, 1924, for two reasons. First of all, if you remember the Schrödinger equation was presented for the first time in 1926. So this is really a classical paper, using only classical physics, because quantum mechanics was not invented. Secondly, I don't know if any one of you remember when Fermi was born. He was born in 1903, so he was only 21 years old when he wrote this paper, so probably younger than most people in this room. So I find that rather fascinating. And as I mentioned, the pulse of this has a width given by the impact parameter, or the distance from the center of a nucleus, divided by the Lorentz factor gamma. And the spectrum will contain photon with energies up to gamma times 1 over the impact parameter. And following Fermi's first attempt, which didn't get very much attention actually initially, there was a quantum mechanical derivation about 10 years later by Weizsäcker-Williams, and that's why this method of equivalent photon is known as the Weizsäcker-Williams method. And we can calculate this photon spectrum for a Fourier transform of the time dependence of these fields. And going back to some very early developments in the 1930s, you know perhaps that in 1932 the positron was discovered by Carl Anderson, and only a couple of years later there was a calculation for the cross-section for two-photon production of E plus E minus pairs done by Lev Landau, and Feynman diagrams had not been invented at that time, but the process Landau considered was basically this, that you have two heavy nuclei, lead nuclei for example, and each of them emit photon, and these two photon fuse and produce an E plus E minus pair. So that calculation was done a long time ago, and very soon after the positron had actually been discovered. So the idea to use heavy ions to study electromagnetic reactions is not new. Actually, I got a quote here from Victor Weisskopf from 1938. He said that charged particles are able to excite nuclei without penetrating into the nucleus by means of the action of their electric field upon the nucleus when they pass nearby. However, for a long time, the energy of the available hadronic and nuclear beams were not high enough to investigate particle production. So for a long time, the energy frontier of electromagnetic and also weak interactions was with lepton beams. And many of you are probably familiar with this. When one did the first observation of so-called deep inelastic electron proton scattering experiments at Stanford in the late 1960s. You had an electron beam which you sent in towards a proton, and then the electron emitted a photon which interacted with something inside the proton. This was at relatively high energy, so the wavelength of the photon was much smaller than the size of the protons. We didn't see the proton as a single object. Instead, it got a view of what was actually existing inside the proton. And what one found was that the cross-section shown here did not follow what you would expect from elastic scattering. Instead, you found that the cross-section was that what you expect from a point charge, what is known as a Mott cross-section. So instead of dropping off like this, as you expected for elastic scattering, you saw more or less a constant cross-section as a function of Q squared. So this was basically the basis and the discovery of the parton model of the proton. And this continued at various places, and the most famous electron proton machine, or the only actually electron proton collider, was HERA at the German laboratory DESU in Hamburg. And this was in operation from 92 to 2007, and there one could study electron proton collisions up to a center of mass energy of 320 GeV. And here I basically mapped out the proton parton distribution functions in detail. And this shows a typical event from here. You have an electron coming in from this side, and then it backscatters and hits a quark inside the proton. And then this quark gets a kick, and when it tries to leave the proton, it excites the fields, and that results in a shower or a jet of particle going in that direction. Now, if you have an extended beam, the electron is a point particle, but if you have a proton or a nucleus that should emit the photon, then to maintain coherence, the maximum photon energy you can get will be given by 1 over the size, h bar c, divided by the size of the object, multiplied by the Lorentz factor. And this means that the photon energy will only be a few percent of the beam energy when you have a hadronic beam. And therefore, it was not until 1980 that one actually observed the first two-photon interaction at the Hadron Collider, that is the intersecting storage rings at CERN. That was in 1980. And that was only, I don't think they even measured the cross-section, but they just made this observation that this process existed. But then later, as you know, probably more energetic hadron than heavy ion colliders entered. And there are mainly three of them, but I'm going to discuss. Actually, the focus will be on the latest one. But we had the Tevatron at Fermilab in operation from 1987 to 2011. And there one studied only one system, that was proton-antiproton collisions. And that was at an energy of 1.96 TeV. And following that came Rick at Brookhaven National Laboratory. It had a slightly lower energy, but it was focused mainly on heavy ion collisions, in particular gold-on-gold collisions. And now, since 2009, the Large Hadron Collider is operating at the LHC, and there one has studied both proton-proton, proton-lead, and lead-lead collisions at in the several TeV energy range. So, and as you know, these machines were not built to study electromagnetic interactions primarily. The most famous discovery at the Tevatron was, of course, the discovery of the top quark in 1995. And at RIC, one has, one can say discovered and also investigated the properties of the quark-gluon plasma. I put a little asterisk here on the discovery because this quark-gluon plasma has turned out to be quite elusive, and there was a claim from CERN that already in fixed target experiments they claimed to have discovered it in the year 2000. But anyway, that has been the main purpose of RIC. And at LHC, you know, the most important discovery so far is the discovery of the Higgs boson in 2013. But let's now get back to Landau in 1934. He calculated the cross-section for this process, and it turns out that it is huge at the LHC. It's actually 200 kilobarns, so it's something like 25,000 times larger than the ordinary hadronic inelastic cross-section. And experimentally, we can only probe a small fraction of that, because if these pairs have masses in this range, MeV range, they will never reach the detector, so we cannot see them. So anyway. But one can calculate this spectrum, and if one does a leading order calculation, that means that one takes this fundamental so-called bright Wheeler cross-section for gamma-gamma going into E plus E minus. That was also derived around the time when Landau and Weizsäcker-Williams were working on this, 1934. And then you convolute it with two photon spectrum. You have one photon spectrum from each nucleus, and then the total cross-section will be given by this integral here. Photon spectrum one, photon spectrum two, and then this cross-section, which is a pure standard QED calculation nowadays. And this calculation is implemented in the Starlight Monte Carlo, which I will say a little bit more about later, but you can find the reference here. And it turns out that this calculation describes the cross-section measured by Alice very well. You can see the differential cross-section invariant mass of the E plus E minus pair here, measured by Alice. And it starts from about 800 MeV and goes up to 10 GeV, and there is no deviation from the QED calculation. And this was published a few years ago. And last year, also ATLAS presented new results on two-photon production of muon pairs. There's essentially not a big difference if you produce an E plus E minus or a mu plus mu minus pair. And they also see very good agreement with Starlight and this leading order calculation, as you can see here. And their measurement actually starts where the Alice measurement ends. So they measure this in the range from 10 GeV up to 100 GeV. And I think it is remarkable and a very nice test of QED that this relatively simple calculation, which is implemented in Starlight, reproduces this measurement over 9 orders of magnitude in cross-section. If you take the variation in cross-section from here down to here, it's 9 orders of magnitude. And the energy scale changes by more than 2 orders of magnitude. And this is clearly a clear extension of the dynamical range compared to with the corresponding measurement in E plus E minus collisions. I show here what the L3 experiment at LEP published on this process, and you see they cover only a small sub-range of what one can cover with heavy ions. So I think this shows that one can really extend the energy range with ultra-peripheral collisions. This, again, okay, perhaps no one is surprised that QED works. Sorry, in the ATLAS data? It goes up to 100 GeV here. I think actually they have a few counts also above 100 GeV, but this is what they showed, so about 100 GeV. And yeah, this is very nice, as I said. I mean, but on the other hand, we knew that QED works, so it was perhaps not unexpected that it should agree. But there are other interesting two-photon interactions. As you know, according to Maxwell's equations, classical photons don't interact. And the same is true to leading ordering quantum electrodynamics. There is no direct gamma-gamma going to gamma-gamma vertex. But in QED, there are higher order terms. And in particular, you can have gamma-gamma going to gamma-gamma through such a loop diagram, where the particles in this loop can be basically any charged particle, any quark, any it can be a W or whatever fundamental particle you have. So, and this means that this cross-section, you can calculate what you expect if you have only the standard model particles, but if there should be some unknown non-standard model particle, that would contribute to this loop and it would affect the cross-section. And the cross-section is also sensitive to any possible anomalous gauge couplings that you might have in this process. And actually very recently ATLAS presented the first observation of this process with 4.4 sigma significance. What you see, what they measure basically is a yield of 13 events. The expected yield from the standard model is 9.9 events, where you have a signal 7.3 and a background of 2.6. So one can say that this measurement is definitely consistent with the standard model, although, of course, with such a low statistics, you cannot really set any strong constraints on any beyond standard model physics. And this plot just shows that these two photons are basically back-to-back, because when you emit a photon from a lead nucleus, its transverse momentum will be very low. So the transverse momentum of this photon and this photon is essentially zero. So these produced photons will basically be back-to-back. And that's what this plot shows, that you have this acloplanarity angle is very close to zero and in agreement with the Monte Carlo expectation. But this is the first time this process is observed at all, and it has already been used to set new limits on the so-called Born-Infeld extension of the standard model. I don't know very much about this Born-Infeld extension, but it's basically a non-linear version of QED. Yeah. One can also produce W plus minus pairs at the LHC. And here, the following diagrams contribute to the leading order. And you have first the diagrams here that corresponds to the so-called triple gamma W coupling, here and these two. This is essentially, these two diagrams also exist if you replace this W with a quark or with a lepton, right? But for the weak interaction, you also have this direct vertex, gamma gamma to W plus W minus. And the triple couplings are better constrained from other measurements, but the quartic couplings are unique to two-photon interactions. And I think it was the first calculation, I'm not sure, of this process in proton-proton collisions was by Professor Christophe Frion, who is here, and his co-workers, published in 2010. And this has been studied in, as I mentioned, in proton-proton collision, and there are certain both advantages and disadvantages using proton-proton versus lead-lead when you want to study two-photon interactions. The advantage is that you have smaller projectile radii. This means that you have a lower cutoff and therefore higher photon energies. And you also have higher integrated luminosity. But then you have no Z-square enhancement in the photon spectrum when you have a nucleus with a large, big charge, and you also have a strong pileup. But nevertheless, both ATLAS and CMS have observed this process, with about 3 to 4 sigma significance. And it's also very recent measurements, but were published last year. And so far, all measurements are consistent with the standard model. But it turns out that these measurements actually set they set the best limit so far on any anomalous gamma-gamma WW coupling. So it has already had an impact in the field. So everything I've said so far has been on two photon interactions. But of course, the photons from the electromagnetic field of one ion might interact directly with the other beam in a photonuclear interactions, an interaction. And one can identify two classes of events. You can have either a so-called inclusive interaction, where the photon hits the nucleus and the nucleus breaks up. What can happen, for example, is that the photon interacts with the gluon inside the target and produces a quark-antiquark pair. This might then come out as two jets from a nucleus. Or you can have so-called exclusive interaction, where you produce some state x while the target remains intact. And this is typically then given by exclusive vector meson production. And in general, the cross section for this inclusive interaction is much larger the cross section for inclusive interaction is much larger than the cross section for exclusive interactions. But so far, most of the experimental attention has been on exclusive vector meson production, and that is mostly for experimental reasons, I would say. When we talked about two photon interactions, we had to integrate the total cross section over two photon spectra. We had to fold it with two photon spectra. In the photonuclear interactions, there is of course only one nucleus emitting a photon, so we have one photon spectrum which we convolute with the cross section for the corresponding photonuclear interaction, and we get a factor of 2 here because both nuclei can emit photons. Of course, we have an ambiguity. You don't really know which nucleus emitted the photon and which was the target. So. And you have this integral, and you must do it between some omega minimum and omega maximum, that is a minimum and maximum photon energy. And there are some natural cutoffs. The minimum energy is typically given by the threshold for this interaction. If you want to produce a CC bar pair, for example, you need a certain minimum photon energy to get the right necessary kinematics. And then for the maximum photon energy, that is usually cut off by itself because a photon spectrum drops rather quickly when you get up. So in practice, the maximum photon energy is much smaller than the beam energy when you're dealing with protons and nuclei. And then you have what is known as vector meson dominance. You know probably that the quantum numbers of the photon is with spin 1 and negative parity and C parity. And this is exactly the same as that of a vector meson. So if the photon fluctuates into a QQ bar state, a quark antiquark state, it will typically fluctuate into a vector meson. And while the photon is in this vector meson state, it will interact strongly with the target. And this hadronic component can materialize if the virtual QQ bar pair is knocked on mass shell, for example, from an elastic nuclear scattering. So you can have a process like this, that the one of a nuclei emits a photon, which then fluctuates into a J psi, for example, a typical vector meson. And then this J psi interacts with the target by exchanging some sort of color-neutral exchange particle. And this color-neutral exchange particle can be either two gluons, or it can be a so-called phenomenological Pomeron. When you have this type of elastic scattering on an extended target, the scattering can basically be both coherent and incoherent, and we are mostly interested in the coherent cross section. And since this is a colloquium, let's get back again to maybe some more or less textbook physics related to coherent elastic scattering. Suppose that you have an incoming particle given by a plane wave, and that then can scatter off two targets, 1 and 2, and it emerges as a scatter. It's elastic scattering, so it emerges as a particle with a slightly different momentum, k prime. So momentum changes from k to k prime. And suppose that you have f1 and f2, if they are the scattering amplitudes at point 1 and point 2, then you know that the total scattering amplitude will be the sum of these, and each amplitude will get this phase factor that is given by the momentum difference times the position of target 1 and 2. And the total differential cross-section will be given by the absolute value of this scattering amplitude squared. And if we now suppose that the scattering amplitudes at 1 and 2 are the same, we call them f, and we introduce the momentum difference q as k minus k prime, then we can write this cross-section, d sigma d omega, as f squared times absolute value of these two exponential functions. And this we can easily simplify to 2 times f squared, 1 plus cosinus q dot x1 minus x2. And if we have small momentum transfers, that is, if q is much smaller than h bar divided by x1 minus x2, so then we see that this cosine will be approximately equal to 1, right? And that means that in the forward, in the limit when q goes to 0, we will have the so-called forward scattering amplitude that will be given by 4 times f squared, and that is 4 times the differential cross-section for scattering of a single source. And note that there is a factor of 4 here and not 2, and that is exactly because we have coherence, so the scaling is 2 squared rather than just 2. And if we now have coherent scattering on the center of, if we have several scattering centers, like if we have a photon hitting a nucleus, we can consider each nucleon a scattering center, then the total scattering amplitude will be the sum of this all these individual nucleon scattering amplitudes. And if we have many scattering centers, we can replace this sum by an integral over the density of scattering centers. And this integral here, of which is basically the Fourier transform of the nuclear matter distribution, is what we call the nuclear form factor. And from this, we also get that the forward different, or in general, the differential cross-section d sigma dt, where t is equal to q squared, will be given by a squared, where a is the number of scattering centers, or number of nucleons, times the scattering amplitude, or forward scattering cross-section in a gamma-proton interaction, and then a form factor squared here, where this form factor will quickly go to zero when the momentum transfer is greater than h over r, which is about 30 MeV over c for a lead nucleus. And this momentum transfer will be, in the real case, in the physical world, this will be basically given by the transverse momentum of the vector meson in an exclusive photonuclear vector meson production. And this was clearly seen in the first UPC result from Rick. That was exclusive rho zero production in gold-gold collisions measured by the star collaboration. And what you can see here is the PT transverse momentum spectrum of these produced rhos. You basically select events where you have only two charged particles in an otherwise empty detector. And then you see what the transverse momentum distribution is of these two tracks. And what you see is this very obvious coherent enhancement here below about 100 MeV, as you expect for coherent scattering of a Gould nucleus. Yes. And this cross-section for exclusive and coherent rho zero production has been measured both by Star and now later by Alice at the LHC. Star measured it at three different energies, starting from about 60 GeV up to 200 GeV, and then Alice has measured it at 2.76 TeV. And as you can see, the cross-section increases dramatically by more than one order of magnitude between Rick and LHC, and this is almost entirely due to the increasing photon flux, the harder photon spectrum, and you have a harder spectrum and you have more photons basically, and this leads to this rather dramatic cross-section. And at the LHC, this cross-section is about 4 barns, so it's about 50% of the hadronic inelastic cross-section, so it's quite large. And you see here that it agrees very well with the starlight prediction. I should brag a little bit perhaps, and I say that this is actually a prediction I did together with Spencer Klein almost 20 years ago, so it's, we are happy with that. But we don't only want to study the raw zero, because it has its limitation since it's a soft probe. But if you go to heavier vector mesons like the epsilon and the J psi, then it turns out that one can actually calculate this process in leading order QCD, perturbative QCD, and one obtains this formula derived first by Ryskin. And the essential feature is that this forward scattering amplitude is proportional to the gluon distribution squared, because when you have a perturbative calculation, you can model the Pomeron as exchange of two gluons, basically.
So what you just showed us, which is the exclusive production of the rho naught. Mm-hmm. Rho naught, I thought, was C parity negative.
Yes.
And aren't the gluons also C parity negative?
Yes, but the point is that there are two. You cannot exchange a single gluon. You must exchange two, otherwise it doesn't work. That's right. Now, if you exchange a single gluon, the quantum numbers wouldn't match up, and it would not be colorless momentum transfer either.
Okay, so one gluon is prohibited on the basis of color.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But if the rho naught is C parity negative, the two gluons are also both C parity negative. It would seem like.
No, if you combine two of them, you can get the zero plus state. Effectively.
So the quantum numbers are all okay?
Yes, yes.
Parity and charge, mm-hmm. and charge conjugation is all okay.
I mean, this process is to a large extent equal to elastic scattering, and that is typically mediated by a zero plus. Yes. So, and the main point again that is that this process then is proportional to the gluon distribution inside the target. And if one looks at the nuclear gluon distributions, there are quite large uncertainties. There are several parameterizations available. They are plotted here. I mean, this is where, if there were no nuclear effects, you would expect this ratio to be one. Simply that the number of gluons in a nucleus scales with the number of nucleons. and then this is plotted as function of the so-called Bergen X, where this X corresponds to the fraction of the nucleus momentum carried by the gluon. And most models predicts that when you reach into this region between 10 to the minus 2 or 10 to the minus 3 in X, you have a reduction in the number of gluons by perhaps up to 50%. So by measuring exclusive vector momentum production at LHC, we can improve this for in the X range between 10 to the minus 2 to 10 to the minus 4, and for a momentum transfer given approximately by the mass of the vector.
Sorry, you said nuclear gluon distribution. Is that for a specific nucleus, or isn't a nucleus?
This is for a lead nucleus. I mean, there are very little data, and it says there. And I think one assumes that it is approximately the same in a gold or a lead nucleus, right? But there is very little data to support this in detail. But that's. Basically, what one, and I mean, what has been collided at RIC and at LHC, it's either gold or lead. So, so this was the basis of a calculation done by Adelui and Bertolani a few years ago, and they assumed that this cross section would scale with the gluon density squared, and then they normalized their calculation to the data in gamma proton interactions, which have been measured at HERA. And then they made various predictions. And the first prediction is that you have no nuclear effects, meaning that the forward scattering amplitude scales as A squared. And then you get this expectation. And then if you take into account these different parameterizations that I had on the previous slide, for example, the HKN07, which has least shadowing, and then EPS09 has a little bit more, and EPS08 has even more. You can see that these different calculations give these different curves here. So the more, the stronger shadowing you have, the smaller cross section you expect here. And then there were also other models on the market. Many of them were based on the color dipole model. And there were also some partonic calculations using the leading twist approximation for to estimate the amount of shadowing. And finally, also starlight just scales this. It's a starlight is a purely hadronic model, and it scales the measured cross section in gamma p using a Glauber model. And so this was the situation before LHC, basically, before we released any data, at least. And then I was not going to say, I'm focusing on the physics and I'm not saying very much on the detectors, but I thought I should perhaps introduce the detector I'm working with, which is the ALICE detector at LHC. And it consists of a central tracking system, where the main component is a silicon-based inner tracking system, and outside of that, a large time projection chamber. And there are also time-of-flight detectors that can help with the particle identification, in addition to the energy loss in the TPC. And the central arm has an acceptance of almost 2 units in rapidity, and it can track all particles with a transverse momentum greater than about 100 MeV. And the trigger in the central barrel is provided by the silicon pixel detector and TOF, and this SPD is the innermost layer of the inner tracking system. And then there is also a muon arm, not at mid rapidity, but at forward rapidities between 2.5 and 4, and you can see it in the picture, you see it here. This has its own trigger capability, and it can track and identify muons. And there are also some other auxiliary detectors like the V0 counters, which are they are sensitive to charged particles, and they are situated in the forward and backward region. And in ultra-peripheral collisions, they are used to define rapidity gaps where you don't have any particles emitted, in covering roughly between 2 to 3 units on each side. And we have also 0-degree calorimeters, 160 meters from the interaction point. And we used this. We used the SPD and time of flight for triggering, and we used the V0 detectors to define rapidity gaps. And then we looked to looked for events which essentially had 2 tracks in an otherwise empty detector. And we were searching for the Jape psi, and the Jape psi has a decay mode into either an E plus E minus or mu plus mu minus pair. And when you make this selection and look at what the invariant mass distribution looks like, it's something like this. You have a very clear J psi peak sitting on top of a background, where this background mostly comes from, it's the physics background, an irreducible physics background coming from gamma-gamma going to a lepton-anti-lepton pair. And we can separate, actually, this is for the muon channel and the electron channel. And when we have these very low multiplicity events, we can actually separate electrons from muons using the TPC DEDX. It doesn't work for central collisions because there you have so many pions that the muons will not be visible above that. And if we make the same selection, we take 2 tracks in an empty detector, look around the Jape psi mass, we see the PT spectrum here, and just as in the star data, it exhibits this very clear coherent peak below 100 MeV or so in transverse momentum. This is again for the dimuon, and this is for the dielectron, and the dielectron peak is slightly broader because the electrons lose energy from bremsstrahlung, and that broadens this peak. But there are various sources of background. I will not go into detail here, but if you look at the interesting region, say below 150 MeV, there are essentially only 2 components. You have the signal coherent Jape psi production, and you have a continuum background from 2 photon interactions producing the same lepton pair. And the result is shown here, superimposed on the models I showed before. And as you can see, it falls almost exactly on the prediction by Alleluia and Bertolone using the EPS-09 parameterization of the gluon distribution. So this result shows that the distribution in the X range from 10 to the minus 2 to 10 to the minus 3 is at least consistent with the EPS-09 parameterization. And since we are here, I should of course mention also the result from CMS on the same topic, which is public, and it is shown here. And as you can see, it agrees very well with the trend seen by Alice. And CMS used a slightly different trigger there. They required one neutron to be emitted, and but they corrected for this by scaling up the total cross section using the Starlight Monte Carlo. And if I now take these measurements into, I mean, if you translate these measurements into the nuclear gluon distribution, you can get a picture something like this. You have the two measurements by Alice here and here, and the measurement by CMS in between. And as you can see, it seems to follow quite well the EPS 09 prediction. And in X-ray region of 10 to the minus 3 or so, the gluon distribution is reduced by 30 or perhaps even 40% compared to naive scaling with the number of gluons.
So can one conclude anything about the parton distribution, gluon distribution screening in an individual nucleon from these data for nucleus?
Not really. I mean, I think that all these assume that you know the gluon distribution in the proton, and then they
just take it from HERA.
Yeah, more or less, yes. Mm. And then they implement various nuclear effects to
photon-nuclear effects.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, this ratio is basically the gluon distribution you have in a nucleus divided by 8 times the gluon distribution you have in a proton. And there is a lot more data, of course, on proton targets from HERA, for example. Yes. So it has much smaller uncertainty than the distribution in a nucleus.
Are there any substantial differences between the proton and neutron PDFs?
Well, I'm not sure how well that is known, because I mean, here I only accelerated protons, right? So there were no deuterons, or so people generally assume that it's the same, but how much data there is actually to support that, I'm not sure about. Probably not, maybe not too much actually, if one should. Okay, that was exclusive production in lead-lead collisions. We can do, of course, the same thing in proton-lead. And here, this will be dominated by gamma-proton interactions, because the probability to emit a photon is proportional to Z squared. So in a proton-lead collisions, you will, in more than 95% of the cases, have the photon emitted by the lead nucleus. And that's an obvious advantage compared with proton-proton collisions, because it removes this ambiguity I mentioned before, that you have a symmetric lead-lead collision, either nucleus can be photon emitter or photon target, and if you are away from mid-rapidity, you don't know which is which. But when you have a proton-lead collision, then you know with at least 95% probability that the photon came from the lead nucleus. And the Alice muon arm is located at forward rapidities, and the kinematics will then depend on the beam direction. So in the case when the lead nucleus moves away, when the proton moves towards the muon arm and the lead nucleus moves away from the muon arm, you will probe interactions in their energy range between 550 and 1160 GeV. And that this W is then the gamma proton center of mass energy. But if you reverse the situation so that the lead nucleus moves towards the muon arm and the proton moves away from the muon arm, then you have a relatively low center of mass energy range here. And at HERA, this process has been measured up to 300 GeV. Here's a compilation of the existing data. There are also some fixed target experiments. And what we found in ALICE was that when we measure in this low energy range, in proton-lead collisions, we get these measured points, and they are in very good agreement with what has been measured previously. But we also have this high energy point, which is up here in the far above what HERA measured before, around 800 GV compared to the 300 GV at HERA. And I should mention that this result is from round one, where we had a square root of S of 5 TV. Last December, we took more data at 8 TV in proton-lead, and there and there we also had higher statistics, so we hope to reach, we hope to cover all this. We hope to go above 1 TeV essentially in gamma B, center of mass energy, with this new data. And the conclusion of this paper is that a natural explanation, because you see, the trend, there is no difference in trend here. I mean, if you take the HERA data and you fit it to a power law, as was done, for example, in starlight, the measured value falls right on top of this extrapolation. So what we wrote in the paper is that the natural explanation is that no change in the behavior of the gluon proton, gluon PDF in the proton is observed between HERA and LHC energies. And this paper was published in PRL, and I can mention that the chair of the paper committee, I was in the paper committee who wrote this paper, but the chair of the paper committee was actually Daniel. So he made a strong contribution here. From time to time I mentioned starlight, the starlight Monte Carlo. And let's say a few words about what it is. It's a Monte Carlo for exclusive two-photon and photon-nuclear interactions at hadron colliders. So basically everything I've talked about up to, until now. And development started actually almost 20 years ago in Berkeley, when I was a postdoc there, working with Spencer Klein. And the model is available on HebForge. And also, it's not just Spencer and me, other people have also contributed to the development of starlight, and we recently published a write-up of this of the Monte Carlo in computer physics communication. So if you want to know more, you can find it. If you look at this webpage, you will find some of the a list of some of the underlying physics paper that form the basis of starlight. But let's move away now from exclusive photonuclear interactions to a more general inclusive interaction. You can, of course, have a situation like this, as I think I already mentioned, that the photon may interact with the proton in the target, for example, a gluon, and that can then produce a quark-antiquark pair, which can have quite high energy. So then these quark-antiquarks leave the nucleus, they will produce two jets of particles. And this will then be characterized by this topology, that you will have a rapidity gap, void of particles between the photon-emitting nucleus and the produced system. But then you will basically fill the entire rapidity region between the jets and the nucleus with fragments from the hadronization of the outgoing quarks and other particles. And this process here depends linearly on the nuclear proton distribution functions, but whereas for the exclusive interaction you had the dependence proportional to the square, so this is less sensitive. On the other hand, there are less theoretical uncertainties in this approach compared with exclusive vector mesons, where you exchange two gluons. And here are some variables one can use then to study this process. You basically define XA, which is a fraction of the nuclear momentum carried by the proton in this interaction, and Z gamma, which is a fraction of the nuclear momentum carried by the photon, and in terms of measurable variables, this is given by the mass of the jet divided by square root of S times E times minus the rapidity of the jet, and for Z gamma, it's the mass of the jet times E to the plus rapidity of the jet. And you assume here that the photon emitting nucleus is moving in the positive direction, and the jet rapidity you can experimentally determine like this, so that you sum the energies of all the particles in the jet and their longitudinal momenta, and then you calculate the rapidity in the usual way. And HT is the sum of the jet transverse momentum. And this was actually presented by Atlas at the Quark Matter Conference for the first time a couple of months ago. And in these basic variables, they see quite good agreement with Pythia, provided that they modify the photon spectrum from the default in Pythia into that used in starlight, because what is implemented in Pythia currently is the photon spectrum for a lepton beam, and that is not really applicable to heavy ion collisions because it's completely different. But once they take that into account, they can actually reproduce this jet cross-section fairly well with Pythia. And this is shown here in the variables rapidity of the jet and the distribution of Z gamma, and also true in for the distribution of this HT, or the total PT of the jet. So I think there will be more results on this and more detailed results, and hopefully this will also help to constrain the proton distributions in the nucleus. Finally, I'm just about to finish, but since this is something I'm discussing with Daniel right now, you can also have photonuclear jets in so-called diffractive events. Then you have a topology something like this, that the proton or the nucleus emits a colorless object, a Pomeron or two gluons, and then that state interacts with the photon and produces jets here. And in this case, you will have the rapidity gap not just between the photon-emitting nucleus and the produced state, but also between the target nucleus and the produced state. And this process has been studied at HERA with proton targets. That's where I took this picture from. At LHC, you of course have to replace this electron with either a proton or a nucleus. Nothing has been done with nuclear targets, so it's really a pioneering work. And it is possible. There are some people who think that they can calculate this process and that it will be a probe for the nuclear gluon distribution. So, to summarize, I hope I've shown you that ultraperipheral collisions is the energy frontier for primarily electromagnetic, but also to some extent electroweak interactions. A variety of final interactions and final states can be studied, and experimentally there has so far been much focus on exclusive vector meson production, but I think this is now broadening to include other two-photon and photonuclear interactions. So, that's all. Thank you.
Any questions or comments? Any questions? Michael, you say more?
Oh, I just think, what do you think the prospects are for electroweak production?
You mean other
W's and D's and so on? That's feasible.
Yeah, W's have already done, as I mentioned, right? If I both CMS and Atlas. Of course, one would like more statistics to really set stringent limits. But then I think you could, in principle, also have an exclusive set production in gamma P interactions. I mean, it's a relatively new topic, this. I mean, many people are still not aware of the fact that you can do all this at LHC, but I think more theorists are getting interested, and I think they will do calculations for various other processes.
And if we get more heavy ion at LHC, we can even do Higgs, and you can do other things. Okay, as I said, Professor Nystrand is here. He's actually in a sabbatical this year, and he decided to spend 1 month, he spent 1 month with us here in Kansas. So if you have time, you can also schedule him later. But let me thank him again for his colloquium.